Hello, I'm Professor Andrew Beer, the Executive Dean of UniSA Business, and it's my considerable pleasure to welcome you all to the seminar hosted by the University of South Australia entitled Businesses Cannot Survive on a Falling Planet. I'm also pleased to announce that today we have over 175 people registered for this event, and I think this speaks to the quality and interest of this topic. Today we have a diverse audience, including staff and students. It's wonderful also to see significant interest from the wider community. As we start, I'll take this opportunity to acknowledge that this land we are broadcasting from today is the traditional land of the Kaurna people, and that we respect their spiritual relationship with their country. We acknowledge the Kaurna people as the custodians of the Adelaide region, and their cultural and heritage beliefs are still as important to living people today, living Kaurna people today. Before we commence, I have a few housekeeping matters to advise you of. Firstly, and importantly, today's event will be recorded and the recording will be made available after the event. Secondly, we will not be using the chat function today for chat. We will use it to share some relevant links throughout the presentation. Thirdly, if you do have any questions you would like to ask of Dr. Sandhu, we ask you to please use the Q&A function. Dr. Sandhu will try to answer as many questions as time allows, and we do apologise if we don't get to yours today. I'd now like to introduce our speaker. Dr. Sukhbir Sandhu is a Senior Lecturer in Sustainability and Ethics at the University of South Australia Business and a researcher within the Centre for Workplace Excellence. Dr. Sandhu's research focuses on social and environmental sustainability issues that confront organisations and society. Doctor in leading management and sustainability journals. Her research on organisational sustainability has been recognised by the prestigious Research Impact on Practice Award from the Network for Business Sustainability. Her research has also been listed in the Financial Times all-time top 100 social science research articles that can lead to a meaningful impact and help improve society. Dr. Sandhu has won numerous other national and international awards for her research and teaching. Dr. Sandhu serves as UniSA Business School Lead for the United Nations Principles of Responsible Management Education, also known as PRIME, P-R-M-E. In this talk, Dr. Sandhu will share her research on how leaders need to urgently reimagine businesses so that recovery from COVID-19 and the maximisation of return on capital can be balanced through imagination, passion and trust. And these are required to navigate the shift from growth to sustainable development. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Andrew. I'm just going to share the slides. And I'm absolutely thrilled that so many people are joining us for this talk. Thank you so much. I think it's really important for the field because what it does is it tells us that these issues are no longer fringe issues, but are quite central to our political societal discourse. So thanks for joining this afternoon conversation. And thank you also for the excellent questions that you've shared. I now have a list of more than 40 questions, and given that our talk is for about 45 minutes, we may not get through all the questions right now, but I'm committed to answering all the questions that you've shared. So Juliet, the coordinator for our social enterprise hub, and I will work together to ensure that all these questions are answered on a website, which we'll share. So please be assured that your questions will be addressed over the coming weeks. And thanks again for the brilliant questions. So what I'm going to talk about today is to share my research on how business cannot succeed on a falling planet. And this is from our dear friend, Charles Dickens. We do live in the best of times, even though under the current COVID circumstances, it might not always seem so. But the 20th century has witnessed unprecedented economic growth. Since 1900, the world economy has increased by a factor of 14. the global population has increased, but so also has the life expectancy. So we now live longer than we've ever done before in our history. But as he says, the best of times, the worst of times. But this progress has also been accompanied by an unintended and sometimes unintentional damage to the very environment on which this progress is based. A study commissioned by the United Nations as far back as 2005 found that of the 24 global ecosystem services, nearly 60% were found to be degraded. And the news does get worse. So there are 9 planetary boundaries that are kind of the safety limits of our existence on this planet. We cross them and there is no coming back. And 4 of these planetary limits have already been crossed. So there is an urgency to this situation. And 10 years ago, if I presented this talk, I would have argued, I would have shown you data from Antarctic ice cores. I would have argued about how climate change is happening. I no longer have to do that. The fact that climate change is happening is kind of undisputed. Our debates are more about whether we go for a mitigation strategy or an adaptation strategy, what kind of a combination of those. So in this graph, it shows how since 1850 to now, the blue ones correspond to lower temperatures, the red ones with higher. Our world is undeniably getting warmer. And the implications that are significant to our land use, to the way we live our lives, to the way we construct our cities, and the way businesses function. Unfortunately, traditional academic research and teaching, we're not moving fast enough and furious enough. A key criticism of business schools across the world is that we are not sufficiently engaging with ethics and sustainability. And this brings into question the very value and legitimacy of business schools. In fact, we as business school academics, we have to take a large part of the responsibility for a lack of action on these issues. We continue praying at the altar of Milton Friedman, who famously argued that there is one and only one social responsibility of business, and that is to increase its profits. So he said this in 1973, this idea somehow continues to be the dominant idea. So how did we end up being trapped in this iron cage of constricted sense-making? How did we end up buying into the argument that the sole function of a business is to make profits, irrespective of the damage it's doing to the environment, irrespective how it's degrading the very systems on which its prosperity is based? Remember, when businesses first came about after the Industrial Revolution and way before that, in a more organized form after Industrial Revolution, they were meant to be a part of the society, to serve society, not to exploit consumers or the environment. And yet somehow we are trapped in this iron cage that the sole purpose of a business is to make profits, full stop. And most management theory and research, we continue to proceed as if organizations lack biophysical foundations. So if I invite you to think, can you think of any organization that can exist without fresh air, fresh water, or fertile soil? And yet our research and our teaching and the way our businesses practices, we continue to believe in this decoupling that businesses can succeed on a failing planet. They cannot succeed on a failing planet. So a large part of my research, I try and focus on this need to recalibrate our radars. So it used to be that 10 years ago, these things were happening in distant countries. So remember when Maldives had that tourism slogan, see us while we are still there, before we're absorbed by the global warming. But now it's happening here and now, right on our doorsteps. So this picture here is from yesterday's news about coastal erosion in New South Wales. Sand dunes serve a purpose. Sand dunes prevent coastal erosion. And of course their value is zero. If we give zero value to their dune protection services, and it makes sense to build our houses, it makes sense for real estate to be developed. But as soon as you start factoring in the economic value of sand dunes, suddenly the equation changes. Then the issue is no longer how we impact the environment, but how much we rely on the environment. And this is a fundamental distinction that I'd like to highlight throughout my talk. It's no longer the conversation on how much we're impacting the environment. It's about how much we rely on the environment to continue our existence into the future. And the clock is ticking, ticking fast and furiously. UniSA Business, I'm really proud. We are signatories to the United Nations Principles for Responsible Management Education. We're committed to sustainable development goals. And we've not recently started doing this. We've been working on sustainable development goals since 2010 and more formally since 2030. So as a business school, we focus specifically on SDG 4, quality education, SDG 5, gender equality, and on SDG 12, responsible consumption. And I noticed from the list of questions that I have that you have questions about responsible consumption, and there are some really good questions about the connection between growth and sustainable development, and I will try and address them as we move through our conversation today. Now, COVID, with all the hardships that we have been enduring because of it, it gives us a unique opportunity to actually pause and reflect on the direction that we are taking as individuals, as members of organizations, as members of society. In fact, many researchers argue that COVID can actually be viewed as a dry run for the impending climate crisis. If climate crisis is left unaddressed, the pain will be for much longer and the implications much more huge. But this can be viewed as a dry run for and use that to sharpen our responses, to develop better and stronger responses. In fact, the pause offered by the pandemic, I would argue, provides a unique opportunity for governments, businesses, and societies to re-examine our collective response on how we're impacting environment and society. Governments, when they start planning on recovery, could think about stimuluses and think about the actions that they're planning. After the global financial crisis, Tesla was born out of one such stimulus, and it's now revolutionized the way we look at the automobile industry. Businesses can use this opportunity to see how do they re-engage with their workforce. And as societies, I think we can pause and start reflecting on this difference between growth and sustainable development. Are we as a society going to commit to linear exploitative growth? Or can we pause and reflect on what might be the difference if instead of just growth, we focus on sustainable development? Can we really grow indefinitely on a finite planet? And in fact, the tools that encourage this misconception that infinite growth on a finite planet is possible, even those tools we increasingly find are flawed. So if academics question GDP, it's no big news. When the economist, the high priest of free market liberalism, when they say that GDP is a flawed tool, that really gives us a chance to sit and reflect. In fact, Amartya Sen, in his Nobel Prize winning address, argued for this difference between growth and sustainable development. He said, instead of just focusing on faring forwards, we should actually focus on faring well, not just on linear exploitative growth, but what would it mean to develop sustainably? And that's where a lot of my research focuses on. It's an incomplete picture if we just focus on economic sustainability. Our picture gets the pieces of the jigsaw fill in much more better if we start focusing on environmental, social, and economic sustainability. I do acknowledge that these things are hyper-objects. They're so big to be comprehended within individual frames of reference. Look at SDG 1, no poverty. It's such a big goal. And look at climate change. These are such big issues that they become so extended in time and space that it becomes difficult to conceptualize these issues in our daily lives. And in my research, what I try and do is focus on the small pieces and how these pieces fit together. What can we do as individuals? what can we do as members of society, and what can we do as members of organizations. And when all of these pieces fit together, I think there is hope moving forwards on moving towards a sustainable development where we can sustain the generations to come and the generations that exist on the finite resources of our planet. So what can we do as individuals? Now I'm going to take you back right to 2010, one of the first papers I ever wrote. It continues to be my most cited paper, and I do not have a good story to tell in this paper. So in this paper, nearly 10 years ago, we looked at the role of consumers in driving sustainability, and we found consumers didn't care. Back in 2010, they didn't care. In fact, worse, they were jealous faced. They would, in all this willingness to pay studies that economists carry out, they would say, yes, we're willing to pay more for environment-friendly goods. But when it actually came to supporting environment-friendly goods, they didn't. And this was a troublesome finding. Fast forward 10 years later, and we have a much more hopeful story today. So along with my colleagues, Professor Sumit Lodhia and Dr. Robert Crocker, we, in our recent research, we're actually finding that there is a shift happening. So we focused on reusable cups, 300 billion of these reusable, of these throwaway cups end up in landfill each year. That's a massive amount. And we found that there is a shift happening with consumers. There's a shift happening with businesses. There's a shift happening with policymakers. Even despite the disruptions caused by COVID, these things are moving forward. So in 10 years, we did find that consumers are starting to shift. In fact, in this article in Conversation, we have a really simple finding that if you want to convince others to do the right thing, start doing it yourself. So if you carry your reusable cup around, people will start mimicking you, and they just feel more comfortable doing it if they see others doing it. So, and that's not a huge change. Jane Goodall, the famous researcher who spent her life studying chimpanzees, said that if each one of us thinks about what we buy, what we consume, and what we throw away, the world will start healing itself. And 10 years later, our research does support exactly the same thing. So we all have an opportunity to use our role as consumers to bring about this change. And now it seems consumers are doing that. As members of society, we can start pressing our governments to take action. Unfortunately, our governments are locked in a 4-year electoral cycle. And these issues, addressing environmental issues, their benefits come in much longer term. And governments are unwilling to take actions on something that's not, doesn't have immediate benefits. But as members of society, we can start asking our governments to take back, to be the government of the people, by the people, for the people. So here I took from the recent climate strike in front of our Parliament House. And it was so heartening to see the young people actually asking for what they believe in. 10 years ago, I felt such an outsider researching these issues. And now you're no longer, it's no longer a fringe issue. As I said, it's impacting our societal and political discourse. And as members of societies, we can pull that lever. If you're not the kind who would rally about, people can create micro communities. So this picture I took in Handoff, which is, I know we've got international attendees. So Handoff's a small town near Adelaide, and this was a cafe in Handoff with this very simple message: take what you need, give what you... They were still selling their coffee, but outside they had this stand about creating this micro sharing communities. If you have anything to give, put it here. If you want anything from here, take it. And I know that my colleagues at UniSA actively are creating these micro communities. So we can do a lot as members of societies. But a lot of my research focuses on the organizational level. What can we do as members of organizations? And I know that a lot of questions you've asked also focus on the organizational level. So this article that we published in the Harvard Business Review actually starts unpacking what can we do as members of organizations? How do we structure the roles so that social and environmental issues, they they can be seen, we can act upon them, what kind of leadership do we need? And in fact, if you read this article, you can perhaps map out where your organization is currently. And we also offer a way forward. How can organizations evolve from where they are to for the next steps? What does it take? And for employees individually, so this is an article that complemented the Harvard Business Review piece, the Network of Business Sustainability, which is about 7,500 practitioners and academics interested in sustainability. So this article that we wrote for NBS actually starts looking at what can you do as an employee in the organization, as someone who wants to bring about change. And we have three very clear messages. If you are concerned about social and environmental issues, if you want to bring about change, you start by framing it as a risk management language. That's a language that managers understand. You get your numbers right. You position how this issue poses a risk. However, numbers by themselves are not sufficient. Once you have the attention of organizational decision makers, you need to be able to engage in storytelling. So one of the managers in our research told us that instead of just focusing on indigenous incarceration rates, how the mining is impacting those communities, she actually would bring in indigenous people to the board meetings, and hearing their story would suddenly drive home the point more clearly than any amount of numbers can do. So in this article, we give very clear strategies on how to start, how to continue, and ensuring that your organization engages with these issues. And then we offer strategies on how can you have broader impact beyond your organization. And one of those strategies is competition. Of course, businesses need to compete, but there are areas they can cooperate in. So competition, cooperation, brought together, competition. You compete in some spaces, but you can cooperate in others. Coke and Pepsi compete for the soft drinks they sell, as long as people will keep buying them, but they can cooperate in the recycling of these cans. So competition enables managers to have broader influence beyond their organizations. In our research, we've also identified the barriers to organizational change. There is an urgency to these issues, and yet why are organizations not acting fast enough, furious enough? And remember, our dear friend Milton Friedman, the only social responsibility of a business is to make profits. His thinking pervades our boardrooms, it pervades our managers, the way they act. And so most organizational incentives are still focused on short-term returns. So when businesses are reporting on quarterly profits, sustainability and environmental issues will often not make the cut because the benefits come in a longer term. Unilever actually did away with quarterly reporting so that to enable social and environmental issues. There's shortage of expertise, and as a business school, we're definitely addressing the shortage of expertise, people who are equipped to understand these unique challenges and how to address them. There are capital budgeting limitations. Often environmental investments demand massive capital budgeting limitations. Our research shows way forwards on how to deal with investors. So organizations that we have worked with tell us how they no longer focus on short-term investors, but they're actually focusing on long-term investors who will understand and get the strategy of moving into a sustainable future. In fact, increasingly my research tells us that maybe it's time to rewrite the business story, move away from Milton Friedman's perspective. And certified B Corps, these are the new kids on the block. These are businesses who have an explicit commitment to being economically sustainable, but also a commitment to environmental and social sustainability. So just being clear here that you can be a certified B Corp, and the next step is that you can be a benefit corp, which is a more US-based legislation. I'm stressing this because there was a specific question on how can we change our laws to enable this. So the benefit corp does exactly that. It is now a fiduciary requirement if you are a benefit corp to be committed to environment, society, and economic sustainability. In fact, there are many Adelaide businesses that are B Corp, and it's such a heartening experience to be able to research them. So Beyond Bank is a B Corp. Unilever, or more precisely, 12 of its brands are a B Corp. So under the previous CEO, Paul Polman, whom The Economist has ridiculed as Saint Paul, the Polman plan is actually trying to figure out how big businesses can make positive contributions to environment and society. In fact, for the remaining 5 or so minutes of my talk, I'll share some examples from my research about businesses who are acknowledging that they cannot succeed on a failing planet, and to be able to sustain into the future, what kind of things they are doing, so that all the arguments that I've made, they actually are captured through real life examples. So Unilever is an example of an organization that has moved away from how it impacts the environment to how it relies on the environment. Patagonia, in fact, this is a really interesting advertisement. Don't buy this jacket. Patagonia ran this ad in the New York Times. And you could be cynical and say, is this just clever marketing, buy this jacket? Because as soon as they ran this ad, their sales actually increased. However, Patagonia is a B Corp, and the intent in running this ad wasn't to, so I'll move back a slide and then come to this slide. So Patagonia is a US business that makes outdoor clothing. So the Australian equivalents would be Kathmandu, for example. So when they ran this Don't Buy This Jacket ad campaign, the idea was not to get, so the idea is that our existing customers should not buy another jacket, but we do want people who still invest in fast fashion clothes that you buy today and have to throw away in a month because they're of such poor quality. These people could shift to Patagonia, acknowledging that fast fashion is often cheaper, but research done by economists looks at the actual cost of buying fast fashion is much higher because you end up buying much more. So Patagonia has this, the Vaughan Weir truck. So if I bought a Patagonia jacket, they would repair it for me for free for the rest of, for as long as I plan to use it, 10 years, 20, 30 years. So that's this Don't Buy This Jacket campaign. Interface, Ray Anderson, when he led this organization before he died, the infinitely recyclable carpet. So carpet that can be in, so they don't sell carpet anymore. They lease the carpet. As soon as its useful life is over, they'll use that carpet to make new carpet. So in his TED talk, he says, not a single new drop of oil, not a single new fiber. So we can grow in newer, different ways towards a more sustainable form of development, as opposed to our current models of linear, take, make, waste society. And William McDonough, who revolutionized this idea that our designs do not have to be cradle to grave, thinks should not be designed to end up in a landfill. Instead, we can go cradle to cradle, the whole idea of a circular economy. And along with colleagues in a project led by Dr. Robert Crocker, we're actually working on circular economy in Australia. This is one of, and I've talked of big examples across the globe. Here, let me take you closer to home. So this is Ryan Loken. He runs Adelaide Advanced Plastic Recycling right here in Adelaide. So all the plastic that you put in your yellow bin, Ryan's organization actually takes all that plastic and then makes it into useful products. In this case, in the picture that I've put up, in this railings, in this bridge. So people all across, internationally, nationally, they are recognizing that business cannot succeed on a failing planet. And there are new models of growth that we can follow. In my research with Biore, which is a Swiss company that makes organic clothes using organic cotton. So when we did this research, which was an ethnographic study, so traditional cotton demands a lot of pesticides, which starts over over a period of time starts poisoning the soils, making the soils pretty much dead zones. Biore works with farmers in India to ensure that organic cotton cultivation, so that the health of soil is revitalized over a period of time. And it works with the farmers to build schools, to build hospitals, achieving economic sustainability along with environmental and social sustainability. So I think the intention of sharing all these examples was to show that it's possible. In fact, for a long time, we've believed that we've been trapped in this bubble. And historians tell us that when people are trapped in this, when we're trapped in these bubbles, really intelligent people, people like many of us would think of ourselves in that category, when we're trapped in that bubble, we start thinking of the reality inside the bubble. So if you think of the industrial age as a bubble, we're trapped in that phenomena where we think that we can grow indefinitely, we can grow through this linear model of growth. Once the bubble bursts, once the larger reality outside starts asserting itself and the bubble bursts, the challenges can be hugely confronting. So it's time for us to start thinking about thinking outside the bubble that we trapped in. So leaders need to imagine life and their businesses outside that bubble, where the maximization of return on capital is important, but it's balanced by imagination, passion, and trust that shape creativity and innovation. Thank you so much, and very happy to answer any questions that you have. So I believe, Tammy and Juliet will send the questions in, but while they're doing that, I have this list of questions that you had been really good and asked me beforehand. So Malcolm, you had asked about the role of population in this whole debate. Now, so Malcolm's question was, on the one hand, we are told that we need to keep increasing our population to maintain economic growth. On the other hand, population is clearly a challenge. So how do we address this tension? And it's a really thoughtful, provocative question. So in my research, a position that I often argue about is that environmental impact, an impact, a bad thing here, we can see it as a population, population, affluence, and technology. All three combine to create a negative environmental impact. And we clearly need to reduce our population. However, there are lots of ethical questions around it. So which are the countries that we're going to focus on reducing the population? So there's lots of ethical and moral questions about forcible reduction of populations. There are claims about why don't we just let some people. My position on this is we definitely need to control population, but not through forcible mechanisms, but through participation on women. So research tells us very clearly that if women, once women have control over their fertility, populations decrease. So if we enable women to be a part of, if we enable women to be educated, to be a part of the workforce, to have control over their fertility, populations will fall in place. So my position on that, populations definitely the big elephant in the room. We do need to address it, but there are also three associated variables with it. So population through empowering women, having control over their fertility, and that itself is a whole box in itself. They'll have control over their fertility if they are educated, if they are a part of the workforce. So that means pulling a lot of other levers, but at the same time, along with population, we also need to address this issue of affluence. So 1 billion people in developing countries consume far less than the millions in the developed world. So we also need to address this simultaneously, population and effluence. And the third lever here is of technology. So ensuring that our technologies are not exploitative, are not environmentally damaging, but actually support the transition to a more sustainable form of development. So Malcolm, population, but along with effluence and along with technology. So there's a great question from Shane about what advice do we have for boards and managers on positively engaging with these issues? In fact, I know that many of our MBA students do the AICD course. So under the AICD recommendations, principle 3 and the principle 6, principle 3 is about ensuring ethical responsibilities. Principle 6 is about ensuring that environmental issues, the boards can no longer ignore environmental issues. There's a legal obligation under our Corporate Governance Act to ensure that they address environmental risks that are being posed. So Shane, there is a legal requirement, but I agree, regulatory requirements can only be step one. They cannot do enough. And beyond regulations, I think it's this issue of ensuring the right culture in organizations, ensuring that our narrative of businesses change, and acknowledging that they need to make profits, but not at the cost of environment and society. And this is done through conversations like this. So 10 years ago, when I was doing my PhD, it was hard to have these conversations. I would say we need to focus on a different form of growth. And people would think, what do you want to sit under a banyan tree? No, that's not the point. And the point, our linear models have reached a capacity. We need more circular models. And Shane, conversations such as the one we're having now, they change the norms, they allow us to explore what's possible. And through this, a lot of my research tells me that people mimic each other. It's what we call as institutional isomorphism. So if BHP does something, if their board has environmental activists on the board, which they do, they have Friends of Earth on board, they have Greenpeace on the board, then Rio is forced to mimic that. So if you're concerned about ensuring that your boards, that you bring about a positive change, if you start doing it, other organizations will be forced to mimic it because there's a huge pressure to fit within the herd. So someone asked me to share the previous slide. I'll move back to that. So I've also been asked to keep an eye on the time. One of the last questions I received this morning was from Sky, who asked about the role of indigenous issues in how can we bring in indigenous perspective. And Sky, that's a brilliant question. I will be giving a much more thoughtful, formed answer in the web page that we're developing. But there's a recent piece that we did on bushfires and rebuilding after bushfires. And one of the core arguments that I make there is that people who've managed this land for 50,000 years, there's so much that we can learn from them in how to deal with these crises. So indigenous ways of managing bushfires to ensure that they did not get out of hand. This is just one case in the point, but there's so much to learn from people who've managed this great mass of land sustainably for more than 50,000 years, and then bring that conversation back into how when we rewrite the story of business. And the bushfire was just one example, but even controlled fire burning, a practice well understood by indigenous populations, needs to be brought into our fire management practices, the more modern versions of it. So there's a question on how do we ensure that the post-COVID global recovery is based on sustainability principles rather than being dictated by Friedmanian economic beliefs? A brilliant question, Sumit. And just like with most of my research, I'm going to use break it up into three parts. So I think COVID's given us a time to pause. So when planet Earth was almost shut for business, it's given us a pause, essence I would argue are really clear. So governments, when they will use the stimulus, businesses out of it, instead of using that stimulus in a, they could, there's an opportunity to use that stimulus to promote renewable energy. There's an opportunity to use that stimulus to start dealing with the carbon pricing issue that we have. If in Australia especially, the whole debate on carbon has gone on for, it's meant the death for nearly three prime ministers over less than 9 years, death in political terms. So COVID actually gives governments an opportunity to see how can, there will be stimulus, and there's an opportunity to see how the stimulus can be used to aid renewables, to aid a more circular form of economy. For businesses, COVID gives an opportunity for a lot of restructuring, and they can start thinking of how different functions can actually start working together. So sustainability does not have to be siloed. Human resources does not, how to bring different functions together. And as individuals, we can start thinking about our contributions to this debate. So I think COVID actually enables us to address, to pause and reflect on these issues at all three levels, government, businesses, individuals. One of the questions that I was recently, one of the last questions, Skies and one of my colleagues, Shruti, had asked about, what do we do with all this plastic masks that we are, they're very clear alternatives. So we can actually support local businesses through buying reusable cloth masks. So we're still being responsible citizens and supporting local businesses. And to, it just needs us to be aware of these issues and acting on them. Now, I had very clear instructions to stop at about 12:42. And I realized that it is 12:42. I will, like as I said at the start, I'm committed to answering all the questions. Any that have been asked now and have been asked before will be answered over the next few weeks. Thank you so much for joining me. It's a huge privilege to be able to share my research. Thank you. And Andrew, back to you.
Thank you very much, Sukhbir. It falls on me now to have the privilege of saying a few words in closing, and of course to thank everyone for their efforts today. I think I learned a lot today from the presentation by Sukhbir. I think I can only agree with her that issues around sustainability are no longer fringe issues for business in Australia and globally. I was somewhat concerned to hear that of the 9 planetary boundaries identified by the Global College of Scientists and the UN, 4 of those boundaries have already been crossed. And it makes us think about what we need to do to sustain our people, our planet, and our businesses into the future. I think Sukhbir made a very good point when she challenged us to remember that business depends on viable ecosystems. And that brings with it a responsibility, yes, a responsibility by governments and especially businesses to ensure that they contribute to that viability. COVID, as Sukhbir has pointed out, is a chance to reset our economies, our impact on the environment, and the way our society operates. It is a pretest, if you like, for the climate crisis we know is coming. It's positive, therefore, that Sukhbir was able to identify green shoots of change taking place within business and change taking place in the relationship between human beings and the environment. And I think if I took away one clear message, is it is model good behaviour. And I would proudly report that I also use a reusable coffee cup. I think for all of us, we need to recognise that the organisations that we work within, purchase from and contribute to can make a difference. And as employees, as Sukhbir has shown, we can also make a difference by modelling good behaviour, by leading others to what we do and how we act. She has shown us through her presentation today that change is possible. So in conclusion, I would like to thank you for your attendance, and also in particular like to thank Dr. Sandhu for her presentation today, which I found riveting. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. And I'm just going to end with what my dear friend and mentor, Carol Kulik, always tells me. What's the best time to plant a tree? 20 years ago. What's the next best time to plant a tree? Right now. Thanks for joining.